Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm gonna do a classic rock reaction. This is the Gallows Pole, man. A live version of the Gallows Pole done by Page and Plant. I believe it was in 94, if I'm not mistaken. And it doesn't say where this was, but in any case, thank you very much for all of those of you who, this was really highly requested, man. A number of you requested this and also sent me the link. So thank you to these folks. There's no way I can list all of you. So I had to follow up. I just did the Gallows Pole studio version just over a week ago. So it's very, very close following with this one. But anyway, man, I know it's going to be cool, so let's get into it. Gallows Pole, live, Page and Plant. Let's get it. That guitar looks heavy as hell.
Oh, did a little while. Think I'll see my friends are gone. Right, many miles.
So this was 94.
So friends, you get some silver. Oh, little gold. What did you bring me, my dear friend? Came from the gallows pole. What did you bring me? Keep me from the gallows pole.
With short hair.
I couldn't get no silver. No, no gold. You know that we had to step far. Keep me from the gallows pole. Riding many miles. Oh, yalla, yalla. Oh, come on, come on, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'd rather you get some silver, little crook. Why did you bring me my money? Keep it from the gallows pole. Brother, I bought some silver. Oh, little crook.
Page. This dude's got so much soul.
Think of seeing my sister calling, riding many of my. Oh, watch out.
Imagine a reunion. I would pay any damn price.
Oh, yeah.
give him applause. Excellent. That was excellent. Page and Plant, Gallows Pole. All right, listen, for those of you who sent me this link, man, was it 94? I believe it was 94. And where are they? Can you let me know where they are? I didn't have any of that information with the links that was provided. So let me know. That was an excellent, excellent rendition. I was wondering, since my reaction last week, how this would sound live. Now I know. Fantastic, man. And this is many, many years later, so at 94. So you're from 70 to 94. Yeah, man. So a decent 25 years. Still, these guys still look good, still sound good. They still have a lot of spry in them, especially Paige. You know, and Paige is, what, 5 years older than Robert? And he's got just so much soul, so much jam, you know. If you take that guitar away from him, he'll probably die tomorrow. But, you know, that's the source of his life and his youthful vigor. Fantastic. That was excellent. Holy. Thanks a lot, man. Thanks to all of you who sent me that link and were just so on me to do this reaction. I understand why. That was really good. So now, I'm not going to assume that everyone saw my studio reaction. So I'm just going to go into my little read and intro, just as if assuming that somebody is just new to the channel and just seeing this for the first time. So just bear with me, those of you who've gone through this process 100 times already. So I'm going to do a super quick read to introduce the band, and then a little info on the song. And then I got a lot of questions after. Okay, so Led Zeppelin. Led Zeppelin were an English rock band formed in London in 1968. The group consisted of guitarist Jimmy Page, singer Robert Plant, bassist and keyboardist John Paul Jones, and drummer John Bonham. The band's heavy guitar-driven sound has led them to be cited as one of the progenitors of heavy metal. Their style drew from a wide variety of influences, including blues, psychedelia, and folk music. After changing their name from the New Yardbirds, Led Zeppelin signed a deal with Atlantic Records that afforded them considerable artistic freedom. Although the group were initially unpopular with critics, they achieved significant commercial success. Led Zeppelin are widely considered one of the most successful, innovative, and influential rock groups in history. They are one of the best-selling music artists in the history of audio recording. Various sources estimate the group's record sales at 200 to 300 million units worldwide, with RIAA certified sales of 111.5 million units. They are the third best-selling band in the US. They were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 95. The museum's biography of the band states that they were as influential during the 1970s as the Beatles were during the 1960s. That's impressive as hell, that last part. It just gets me every time. Gallows Pole. Gallows Pole, or The Maid Freed from the Gallows Pole, is one of the many titles of a centuries-old folk song about a condemned maiden pleading for someone to buy her freedom from the executioner. The ballad exists in a number of folkloric variants from many different countries and has been remade in a variety of formats. For example, it was recorded in 1939 as The Gallows Pole by folk singer Huddy Leadbelly Leadbetter, and the most famous version in 1970 as Gallows Pole, an arrangement of the Fred Garlick version by English rock band Led Zeppelin on the album Led Zeppelin 3. Oh yeah, you know what? Sorry to break into my reading here. I just want to give you guys an update, man. I recently, just a couple of days ago, came back from visiting my pops, and I played this song for him, and immediately he recognized that it was Gallus Pole by Leadville. He's still calling it Gallus Pole, but not only did he recognize it, but he really, really embraced the Led Zeppelin cover of it, and said that Lead Belly was really, really worthy of this. And if Lead Belly was around, he would definitely give it a thumbs up. My dad is into the whole thumbs up thing. So he gave this rendition of Gallows Pole by Led Zeppelin two huge thumbs up. And his expression was really quite something. I wish that I could have turned the camera on, but he's an old, stubborn old black man. And, you know, he's not into that sort of thing. But I did get his permission to kind of give you a little report on how he took this song. I was wondering about it because it's that split between blues and folk and the acoustic and all of the other things that accompany it. So I was kind of wondering, and I was a little iffy about it. So he also did like the folksy sound in Tangerine as well. He's leaning more towards the blues sound, but he still knows that the folk and the blues sound were very, very tight and intertwined. So he does have a little bit of an embracing tolerance for the folk as well. So he isn't just too lenient on one side, which is great. He was a little bit more open-minded than I thought he would be. So props to you, but anyway, yeah, let me just keep reading. So this is based on an old blues song called Gallus Pole, which was popularized by Lead Belly. The song is considered traditional, meaning the author is unknown. Jimmy Page got the idea for this after hearing the version by the California folk singer Fred Garlick. Page explained when previewing the song for Melody Maker, quote, "He was one of the first white people on Folksways Records to get involved in Lead Belly. We have completely rearranged it and changed the verse. Robert wrote a set of new lyrics. That's John Paul Jones in mandolin and bass, and I'm playing the banjo. 6-string acoustic, 12-string and electric guitar. The bloke swinging on the gallows pole is saying wait for his relatives to arrive. The drumming builds nicely," unquote. Jimmy Page. The lyrics are about a man trying to delay his hanging until his friends and family can rescue him. Although there are many versions of this song, Led Zeppelin's is unusual in that it ends with the hangman hanging the protagonist despite all of his bribes. No, yeah, he knocks boots with his sister, probably takes all of the gold or whatever else that they brought to buy his freedom, and he gets hanged anyway. That is some cold shit. Most other versions end with the hangman setting the protagonist free. A similar folk song called Slack Your Rope was sung by an Arkansan named Jimmy Driftwood. He adapted the words from a 15th century British ballad when any crime could be paid off with money right up to the last step of the gallows. In his version, the criminal is definitely a woman, and her lover rides up and pays her fee. This is the only Led Zeppelin song that features a banjo. Jimmy Page wrote it on a banjo he borrowed from John Paul Jones. He had never played the banjo before. Jimmy Page and Robert Plant teamed up again to record this song for an MTV Unplugged set. It's featured on the very best of the MTV Unplugged album, and the duo are listed simply as Page and Plant. Now, I don't believe that this version of what I just saw is what they're referring to here, the MTR, unless I'm wrong. Let me know if this is what I saw and what year. Well, I'm thinking 94, but I could be wrong. Jimmy Page has claimed that this is his favorite song off of Led Zeppelin 3. The band used some lyrics from this song on their 1975 track, Trampled Underfoot. This is a rare Led Zeppelin song that speeds up as it goes along, a technique Jimmy Page also used on Stairway to Heaven. Reception. In a retrospective review of Led Zeppelin 3 Deluxe Edition, Christopher Lenz of Consequence of Sound gave Gallow's Poll a positive review, writing the track is an excellent representation of Page's acoustic banjo. Lenz further wrote that Jones joins the fun as well, as he adds some mandolin flourish to the mix, complementing and completing the song. Excellent. Fantastic. Yo, man, that was a great performance. And, you know, 25 years later, I've been getting turned on to the concept of revisiting songs, especially after they've been around for a while. Just the other day, I did a Rolling Stones reaction of Midnight Rambler, and it was 31 years in between their one of their first concerts and then their 2003, and it sounded just as fresh, just as cool, even though many lineups later, many years later, of course the gents are older and whatnot. Mick Jagger was still really, really fantastic frontman, and they sounded good, looked good, and the song itself had evolved a little, but the main signature of it was still there. And so I've been intrigued with the whole idea of the characteristics of an actual song lately. Before that, I did a reaction to The Train Kept a Rollin', and that song has been so influential and so present in the evolution of modern rock as we know it, starting from way, way back. I think it was Tiny Bradshaw in the bebop era, going all the way to Led Zeppelin and then Aerosmith and then Motorhead. So many have covered that song, and that song has influenced so much, and over the years it's evolved so much. So this idea of checking out songs has really started to appeal to me, especially its stages of evolution over a period of time. So I'm going to look into that further, especially with Led Zeppelin. I don't know if I'm going to do back-to-back, select the studio and then the live rendition after, or maybe break them up. I'm not quite sure how I'm going to approach it. We'll see. I'm also getting into the arena where there's going to be some things that are a little bit more on the exclusive side. We'll see how that goes. But anyways, and I'm just getting way ahead of myself. These are just thoughts. So back to this performance. I have questions, I was saying. I got a couple of questions. I know that Page and Plant did their thing in the mid-90s. And it got a lot of people excited for a reunion. And even though I was deep into my R&B and hip-hop and rap at that time, I was still at least aware that Page and Plant were doing their thing. And I remember the buzz questions along with my colleagues and some of my friends who do follow classic rock, how excited they were. But the question was, where the hell is John Paul Jones? And why are they just doing a little tease between Page and Plant? And how come they just don't do a Led Zeppelin reunion? Even if it's just a small reunion, they're older, they might not want to do a complete tour, but a Led Zeppelin reunion where they do a couple of really good select dates and quench everybody's thirst for it, because they've got Jason Bonham loaded in the chute, ready to go. He's basically just, just waiting. So he's prepped, waiting, and ready to go. So why not? So here's my question. Back then, at that moment in time, surely they gave thought to it. I know that, I think it was Plant that said that it was just a spur of the moment thing. They just got a burst of energy and they're like, yeah, let's do it. Well, why didn't you extend that energy to include John Paul Jones and Jason Bonham when you had these elements in place ready to go? Like I said, a short little Led Zeppelin, even a little quick flash would have been really, really awesome, even more so than just Page and Plant by themselves. So why didn't that happen? That's my question. I know that there's probably relationship issues, other issues. I know Page might have been too much to go full-blown Led Zeppelin because he's missing John Bonham. These are just factors, but let me know what specifically if you know? That's my question. And because what I'm looking at as I'm getting into Led Zeppelin is that relationship-wise, they're at least amicable enough to get together, be in the same room, sit side by side, receive their Hall of Fame status. They got their Kennedy Center honors. They sat together. They got together for the O2 concert for Mr. Urbanton, Ahmet Urbanton, the CEO of Atlantic Records, the guy, I guess, responsible for giving them all of that great creative freedom. So yes, they have a love for this man because he definitely was those instruments in helping them with their artistic freedom becoming as successful as they were. So I totally get how they would want to give him the highest amount of honors and praise. So necessitating them getting together, I get that. So I guess my second question is, they got together after that, but no more. Why didn't they extend a little bit? Is the status of the relationship so strained that they couldn't extend from that just a little bit for a mini tour, a few more dates, just to, like I said, quench the thirst of the fans, you know? Just hop around a little bit, maybe do a Madison Square Gardens, some key places, maybe 4, 5, 6 concerts, and then we're good. You know what I mean? So why didn't that happen at that point in time? What's the story behind that? I'm just asking these questions just to get into the meat and potatoes and the fiber of it, because it's not written down anywhere. And you got to grab these little bits and pieces. So help me out with that. Answer those questions for me. Why didn't they do a slightly extended tour, a few concert dates, just to satisfy the thirst of the Led Zeppelin fans? Because they're capable, they're healthy enough, they jam well, according to a lot of you who've seen. I haven't seen the O2 concert footage yet, but from what I'm hearing, they haven't missed a beat, and at their age, they're still capable. So what is the deal? Why are they not doing it? That's my question. Answer those questions for me. And what's the status of their relationship now? How is it? Are they on good terms? Are they on terms where they could possibly get together again? Or is it a completely wash, no way? Let me know about that. What's the status of their relationship? Because I'm thinking that at the very, very end of it all, it's the status of their relationship that kind of keeps them from getting together and hanging out with each other long enough to do even a small reunion concert tour. Am I right about that? Is it a relationship thing? Because I don't know if it's just about Robert Plant missing John Bonham anymore. I know that that is probably a very strong factor, but I wonder if that is just the only reason. Answer those questions for me. You see, I had a lot of questions. So, but anyway, man, let's go back to this. Regardless of all of those questions, regardless of all of that stuff in my mind that's unanswered, for what it is, that was an excellent, excellent performance, an excellent live rendition of a classic, classic song. A classic rock song, folk rock song, remade from a very, very, very vintage folks blues song. So, I mean, my pop is 80, and this stuff goes back so far, you know. So this is the stuff that he was chewing on back in this in his teenage years and his young adult years. So, yeah, fantastic stuff, man. And the way that they produced the modern sound but still complementing the vintage sound, that is the thing about Led Zeppelin that I value the most, in seeing them and hearing them covering these old folks and blues tracks. So hats off to them. But anyways, man, I'm just hoping that there is still a possibility for a reunion. Let me know if that is just wishful thinking at this point, okay? Anyways, hope you enjoyed my reaction. And thanks very much for tolerating all of my questions. Answer them for me as best as you can, okay? Fill in those blanks for me, because it's still a big couple of blank spaces where the status of their relationship versus why they're not doing a reunion is concerned. So that's it for now, man. I'm going to continue on this Led Zeppelin journey, and I'll see you in my next Led Zeppelin reaction. Peace.